Wow, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to New Orleans. Thank you, Azucena, for being here. We're so thrilled to be here in this wonderful town, and on behalf of the NCLR Board of Directors, staff, and the entire NCLR familia, thank you for joining us at this year's annual conference and today's National Affiliate Luncheon. Before we begin, I want to thank Mayor Mitch Landrieu and the City of New Orleans. They have been terrific, and you all have welcomed us with such an incredible energy. It's truly great to be here. Let's thank the mayor for rolling out the red carpet for us. It's terrific. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge my predecessor, someone who we all know and admire. We're thrilled that Ambassador Raul Izaguirre is here with us today. Thank you, Raul. We're thrilled that you'll be with us for the rest of the conference as well, so thank you. The National Affiliate Luncheon gets the conference off to a great start every year, and this year is no exception. Back home, you, our affiliates, help thousands of our Latino families open the door to the American dream every day. You are our most important partner in making NCLR's mission a reality. And in honor of NCLR's 45th anniversary, can I hear it for our 45th anniversary? In honor of our 45th anniversary, I want to share a little bit more about our original affiliate partners. Their legacy of incredible work began decades ago when a handful of these dedicated public servants worked to bridge the service gap and help empower Hispanic families. Our affiliates now carry forth their vision every day, and today, as we recognize a few outstanding organizations, we also pay tribute to our original 7 affiliates. Please turn to the screens for more on the profound beginnings of NCLR's most cherished relationship with its affiliates.
At the height of the Chicano Civil Rights Movement, a trio of visionary leaders, Ernesto Galarza, Herman Gallegos, Julian Zamora, traveled the Southwest, visiting Hispanic neighborhood after neighborhood. They saw that what our community needed was an institution that would help support and grow local Mexican-American community-based organizations. These 3 men turned their vision into reality by creating the Southwest Council of La Raza. Today, thanks in large part to Raul Izaguirre and his 30 years of leadership, the National Council of La Raza is now a pan-Latino organization serving affiliates across the country, including the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico. But it all began with 7 groups who were the first to join this new and untested organization called the Council. They are, in many ways, pioneers. We salute them and what they were able to accomplish with so little. This is their story.
In the 60s, there was a tremendous amount of social change coming about. You had the Civil Rights Movement. People were starting to protest against the war. People were starting to sit around the table and talk about the disparity between our economic power and our political power, where we were more than 51% in school districts and not one Mexicano or Mexicana was on the school board or on the city council or the board of supervisors.
There was a big movement going on to end that discrimination, or at least to begin the fight to end that discrimination.
So Ford authorized a planning grant of $25,000 and asked me to explore the possibility of organizing some kind of a regional structure. We then incorporated the organization into what was to be called the Southwest Council of La Raza.
The notion of affiliates was really developed over time, including what their role was, whether they would be on the board, whether there was going to be an affiliate council. So all of those concepts evolved.
In the beginning, it was a question of unification, of working together to solidify our political power, whether it was in California or Arizona or Texas or Colorado, whatever. We were all united. This was the essence of self-determination, coming together and exercising our vote and our demands on society, on government.
The issue of women on the board or in running the affiliates was always, it was an issue from the very beginning. And it wasn't pretty, actually. There was a big fight over one of our first Latinas, Graciela Olivares. She actually was sort of kicked out of the National Council of La Raza because she had the temerity to speak up. It finally was resolved where they said it had to be equal. But if you think about the time, that was revolutionary. When that decision was made, that was a revolutionary decision.
So I think we have a lot to be proud of from the early beginnings of the council. It showed that Hispanics could be organized. We made a breakthrough in philanthropy. And thanks to the ongoing leadership of the executive directors that followed, NCLAR has risen to new and important heights in America as a spokesperson for justice and equity.
The voice is still there. The winds of change are still coming because they laid the right foundation and it withstood the test of time.
I wouldn't in my dreams believed what has happened to the National Council and to its affiliates in terms of their leadership, in terms of their power, in terms of what they really provide to the community in terms of services and opportunities. It's an incredible history.